We're now joined by Surigao del Sur Representative Johnny Pimentel. Congressman Pimentel, good morning to you.
Good morning, Karen, and good morning to your televiewers.
All right, just for our viewers so that there's an understanding, Congressman Johnny Pimentel is a member of PDP Laban, the same party wherein Congressman Don Gonzalez, now promoted to senior deputy speaker. They both are in PDP Laban. So let's start with that. Congressman, what happened? What happened, I think, in the closing of the plenary, that was May 17, the closing, when Gloria Macapagal Arroyo was demoted from senior House Deputy Speaker? What happened exactly?
Well, it was just a prerogative of the Speaker. You know, he's the leader of Congress, and I believe it is within his power to reorganize Congress to see what this is the best for Congress, no? Well, probably by this time you already heard that there were rumors, but that there was an ouster plan. But I am not privy to that. I do not know the details. But last week, there was some reports going around that indeed there was some plan to oust the leadership in Congress. So probably it was just right, or the Speaker has to do what has to be done, and that is to nip in the bud whatever plans, or to thwart the plans of any move to challenge his leadership. So it was just a political exercise in Congress, and I don't think that we should exaggerate this anymore. You have seen what transpired yesterday. I believe that tensions have already been diffused with what you have seen yesterday. Senior Deputy Speaker Congressman Don Gonzalez took his oath in the presence of former President Gloria Arroyo. And we went about the session in a normal business as usual day. It was a routinary day. There were no tensions. There were no commotions. We were able to transact the order of business in a usual way. We passed bills on first, second, and third reading. Actually, wala talaga nangyari, as if nothing happened. So let it
okay.
be.
I think, all right. Well, no, Congressman, I'm hearing you right here, but it's easy. Of course, it was a usual day, as you describe it. But let's go back to the fact that neither Arroyo nor Gonzalez were actually physically present at the plenary hall on Wednesday when the decision was actually made to demote her. But let me start first with this. Does the Speaker respond to rumors? Because I've spoken with a few sources and they've said the same thing on rumors to oust him. But do you believe that former President Gloria Macapagal Arroyo was actually putting people together? She did travel with some congressmen, but do you believe that there was truth to the rumors?
Well, I really don't know what transpired, because as I've said, I want to make it clear that I do not have first-hand information. I was never in a meeting with anybody, with former President Gloria Arroyo, when, if ever, she insinuated that there was a plan to challenge the leadership in Congress. So I want to make that clear. But last week, actually as early as 2 weeks ago, there were some reports, accordingly, that there was a plan to oust the leadership. So as what I told you earlier, it was incumbent upon the Speaker to thwart any plans. You know, we have so many work to do in Congress, and the Speaker does not want to be distracted by this challenging the leadership. So I believe that he did the right thing, no? So ngayon, normal naman tayo. Wala naman nangyayari. We still have how many session days? I think 5 session days until we do the recess. And there are still some pending priority bills under the executive agenda of President Marcos, and the Speaker wants to be focused on the approval of these pending bills. There are 42 actually priority bills of the President. We have already approved, I believe, 31 or 32, and there are still some about 8 or 9 or 10 that are pending, and the Speaker wants this approved before before recess. So dapat let us focus on this. As far as I'm concerned, I believe the hype on these rumors, the hype on these Kudita rumors is already over. You have seen what had transpired yesterday. And I know that Congressman Dong Gonzales had a meeting yesterday with former President Arroyo, and I believe all everything ends well, no? So let us now focus on it. And I hope, and we would like to request from media na wag na masyadong exaggerate ito, because it will just create, you know, medyo makakagulo lang ang Kongreso kung palagi itong pinaano ng media.
What is the effect of clearly right after the demotion of former President Arroyo as senior deputy speaker, you had Vice President Sara Duterte resigning from Lakas CMD?
We really don't know what is the reason of Vice President Sara. And we respect her decision. That is your right. That was her prerogative, whether she should stay or resign from Lakas. As I've said, we really do not know the reason. If you will look at it, probably it was a way of supporting President Arroyo, but that is only my opinion. We really do not know, no? But besides that, I think that would not affect whatever work we're doing in Congress.
Why Don Gonzales? Who chose Don Gonzales? Was he handpicked by Speaker Martin himself?
You know, being a senior deputy speaker, he must have the trust and confidence of the speaker, because it is the second highest officer in Congress, no? It's the highest, the second highest position. So therefore, kailangan talaga trusted niya yung senior deputy speaker. Now, Congressman Don Gonzales is already a 5-term congressman. And they were together, I believe, in the 14th Congress. Speaker Martin and Cong Don Gonzales goes a long way. They are close friends. Aside from being close friends, I believe that Speaker Martin saw in Gonzales the capability to become the senior deputy speaker. Okay. And I have been with him for the past 3 terms, and I've seen him how he works. He's a diligent, he's a workaholic, and I think he deserves also that position.
All right. Okay, so let's talk about the landscape in the lower house right now. How many congressmen are now with a PDP?
No, let me make this very clear.
Yeah.
I know that you'll be asking about the support of the congressman to Speaker Martin. The leadership in Congress is very, very stable. The support to Speaker Martin among all the congressmen is very, very strong. At the moment, all the political parties have already manifested their support. They have already issued statements, all the political parties. We have a supermajority coalition that supports Speaker Martin. Now, let us look at the numbers. Lakas CMD has 72 members, and they all support definitely Speaker Martin. The second biggest party is NUP, which has 48 members. NPC has 39 members. NP has more than 40. PDP Laban has 29. And the partyless members, I think 50 are supporting, if not all, are supporting Speaker Martin. So if you will total that, we have at least 280 members out of 314. That is almost 90% already, who have already signified or has manifested their support to Speaker Martin. So the support to Speaker Martin is very solid, is very strong.
And do you think, Congressman, yes. Pimentel, this overwhelming support for Speaker Martin today translates eventually if he chooses to run for president?
Can you, nawala ang signal mo, can you rephrase that again?
Okay, do you believe that the overwhelming support for Speaker Romualdez today will eventually translate to support for the presidency if he chooses to run?
You know, that is a very hard question, Karen. That is a hypothetical question. Speaker Martin has not made any pronouncement with regards to his political ambitions in 2028. He has more 5 more years to serve as Speaker, because I'm very sure in the 28th Congress, he will be elected again as a Speaker, because you cannot be Speaker unless you have the support of the President. And we know very well that the President will serve until 2028. So therefore, I presume that Speaker Martin will also be serving as Speaker until 2028. The Speaker has his cards close to his chest, and I cannot comment on that, whether he has aspirations for the presidency. But I believe that he is a very outstanding Speaker. I think he's one of the best Speakers, if not the best Speaker that I have served and I have seen. He's a very compassionate leader. He's a consultative leader, not a dictatorial leader. He always consults with congressmen if ever any decision will be made in Congress. So he's just like a father to us. He helps us all the needs of the congressmen.
Okay. All right. Well, you've spoken about just, you've described him as a leader, but my sources tell me that there are also some who have been unhappy in terms of project appropriations. I wanted to ask you about the appropriations chairperson, Zaldy Co., so far as in crafting and the implementation of projects. Sources tell me budgets and projects are, of course, always traditionally and historically connected to talks of leadership and changes and supposed coups in the House. So for a rumored coup to erupt or come out, some would say would mean that you do have some congressmen who are unhappy with the way projects and the budget is distributed.
You know what, Karen? The budget for each district is not really equal. It's not really the same. It depends on the road network of each district. We have 250 districts all over the Philippines. Mm-hmm. Now, there are districts that have, let's say, 5 billion pesos allocation. There are districts that have only 1 billion. In fact, Metro Manila districts are less than 1 billion pesos. Kasi ano pang i-improve mo dito? All the roads are concreted. They all have the infrastructures that are needed. So their allocation is smaller compared to other provinces or other districts.
But what do you say to what do you say to somebody?
You could never really say that it should be equal, because
it's
the need
not about equality. But what do you say to, I have sources where some congressmen are saying those that are close to the Speaker and allied with the Speaker are getting more than the usual share of the budget. Kumbaga, ang sinasabi, sobra-sobra na raw. Clearly,
well,
they have not come out.
What is your take on that? Maybe your sources, the one who reported your sources, are just sour-grating. Maybe they are out of the loop, or maybe they did not support the Speaker, or they're not really, you know. I don't think that is the real situation. I think the Speaker is very, very fair in distributing funds, on allocating funds for each district. As I've said, it's just like a father to us. He's a very good leader. He hears everything. If you think that you are deprived of an allocation, you can go to the Speaker and he will try to find a solution. So,
all right.
If ever there were some congressmen that are, these are only a very, very few.
Okay. Now, yesterday, Lacas and PDP congressmen were asked to join Speaker Romualdez and the new senior deputy speaker after he was sworn in. My sources tell me you were all at the lounge. What happened exactly at the lounge was a partnership agreement.
Yes, yeah, right.
What happened there? What was involved?
Yes, right after the oath taking of Senior Deputy Gonzalez, we proceeded to the executive lounge, wherein we had a signing of the alliance agreement. It's just an alliance between Lacas CMD and PDP with four provisions stated there. And one, of course, is that the alliance will take effect effective yesterday until the adjournment of Congress in 2025. And number two is that the PDP in Lacas agrees to give their unequivocal support to President Marcos, to his executive and legislative agenda. Number three, we also agreed that Lacas and PDP will give our full support to the leadership of Speaker Martin. And number four, both parties agreed to give their full support to the legislative and executive agenda of the president. So that is exactly what is stated in the alliance. Mm-hmm. So it is a partnership between PDP and Lacas CMD to give our full support to the president, to Speaker Martin, and to the agenda and to the that has to be done to support the direction of the president.
All right. I'm curious right now with what's happening in Lacas. Are you open to actually offering the speaker to join PDP?
Well, I don't think if ever, even if we offer the chairmanship to Speaker Martin, he will not accept that because he's already the president of Lacas CMD. Mm-hmm. He won't need the PDP anymore. Okay. What we have here is a partnership, alliance, agreement that we will support each other in terms of work in Congress, in terms of support to President Marcos, in terms of support to Speaker Martin. I don't think he will agree to head PDP Laban. It's just an alliance.
Okay. All right. My last question, sir, because we are going to be speaking with Mayor Majul regarding the Marawi rehab in a bit, is when it comes to parties in the Philippines, let's face it, Congressman, parties are a dime a dozen in the Philippines. It's so easy to leave a party. It's so easy to start a new party, as we've seen through the years, Congressman. And now they're saying there's a new political formation that's coming, that's being formed. And I wanted to ask you about this. It's the Kilusan ng Nagkakaisang Pilipino. It's a group of seasoned former and current lawmakers, supposedly respected people in their own provinces, and they want to be accredited as a national political party, and they want to field candidates for the 2025 senatorial race. What are your thoughts on that, and do you know about the party?
Actually, Karen, it started as a movement or sort of a coalition. In fact, I was there during the first meeting held in EDSA Shangri-La, wherein Secretary Benhur Abalos was the guest speaker. Actually, as I said, it was a movement supported by, it was a multi-party movement, and the objective was to support the programs of President Marcos. It was a multi-party movement. But then, through time, it evolved into a political party. Now, they have, I believe, applied KNP as a national political party. They will have their first hearing sometime probably this week or next week. But then, Karen, applying for a political party is not that easy. You know, probably they think that after the hearing, it will be approved immediately. No. Because there are some requirements. They have to go through the process. Then the process is very, very tedious. for an application of a national party, one of the requirements is that you must have your officers in each of the 82 provinces, meaning you should have officers in the 82 provincial chapters. And these officers will have to be verified by the provincial COMELEC officer, and that will take time. And then after that, COMELEC will have to evaluate it. So
you don't, you're not hopeful. Is that fair to say you're not hopeful?
No, I'm not saying I'm not hopeful, but I'm saying it's not easy. It would not be easy to have it approved. No, it will take time.
All right. On that note, Congressman Johnny Pimentel, I want to thank you for joining me today. I do hope to speak with you again soon.
Okay, thank you very much, Karen.
All right, you take care, sir.